So I'm here because I get a lot of questions about citrus care indoors, and it's not something that I typically grow indoors. So I wanted to link up with Byron from Logee's because they grow a lot of citrus trees. So we're going to be talking about care and propagation today. And I also have to apologize because there is somebody with a chainsaw in the back, so you probably will get little elements of chainsaw throughout this video. But otherwise, I think we'll be in the clear.
Today we're going to be talking about the Meyer lemon, and but this goes for all citrus. So in terms of its care and generally in terms of its propagation, there really isn't a lot of difference. And the Meyer lemon is a very popular lemon right now. It's a culinary lemon. And actually a little bit on the history of that, it's not a true lemon. It's actually a hybrid between, I believe, a sour orange and the table lemon that we know. And it was brought into the country in the early 1900s or late 1800s to Fairchild Gardens. Fairchild was doing a lot of collection, and it came out of China. The difference between it, not only in terms of its culinary use, because it has a lot of rich flavor to it, is it's also very cold tolerant. So this is someplace where they're growing it in a way commercially. They could bring it a little farther north and it can take, you know, colder temperatures, maybe a little bit of freezing, where a normal lemon would die off. And it also makes a great container plant, but generally speaking, most citrus make great container plants. And that's why people use them so much. I mean, they can be grown in pots, obviously, and they can be maintained at relatively low size. This is a very old Meyer lemon right here. It probably goes back two decades, maybe longer.
Wow.
And you can see it's got quite a few fruit on it this year. We do use it for propagation, so it probably would be heavier fruited if we had not pruned off a lot of the flowers so much. But it's lived in this pot for, you know, years, you know, decades.
So it doesn't need to be repotted as much.
No, right. Yeah. And so we really never repot it. It just stays in that pot. And the critical thing is, of course, with all plants, is keeping the roots healthy.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and you're taking cuttings, because I know some people will say, oh, I spit out like an orange seed or I spit out a lemon seed and I put it in a pot, and all of a sudden, and sometimes they revert back to a thornier one, or will it give you the same exact?
The citrus are funny in that most of them will come exact, and I'm not exactly sure how that works botanically or in terms of the genetics of that. But if you plant a lemon seed and you're young, very young, you may see it fruit. But generally, if you plant a lemon seed, you'll never see the fruit on it. And and there's differences in citrus. The citron will fruit about in 3 years from seed. But lemons and the edibles, tangerines and such things, we had a plant here, it's no longer with us, that went 35 years and then started to fruit.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's a long-term project, takes a lifetime almost. So that's one of the reasons why we graft, and also that we propagate vegetatively from the mature plants. So when we take cuttings off of this plant, these plants here will come quickly into flower, and very quickly. I mean, this is a tray of young cuttings that's less than a year old,
right.
And you can see it's covered with buds on
it. Yeah, already, look at this.
And even little fruit, look at the little lemons
oh,
grown.
Oh, wow, look at that, it's so cool.
So actually, in terms of fruit in containers, citrus are really great plants for that. They come into fruit, they produce heavily at very young ages, and they can be maintained for many years at whatever height is desirable.
And I think for somebody who lives in the Northeast, you're here in Connecticut, I'm in New York, it's something a little bit more exotic and probably goes back to even when your grandfather brought in the lemon tree, you know, from Philadelphia. There's something exotic about it because you can't grow really lemons outdoors here.
Right. In terms of our growing of them, there's a couple things that we want to focus on. One is root health, and citrus do have susceptibility to root pathogens, and that's usually what takes them out. I mean, there's two ways you can kill a citrus plant. You can never water it, or you can lose your root system. And if you keep a healthy root system that's quite inactive, you're going to make it great strides. And so here's an example of a plant where the root system is very healthy.
Mm-hmm.
They're all white. Now, if we pulled this out of the pot and we saw brown roots here and we touched them and they fell apart, that's a symptom of some type of root pathogen that's gotten in there. And so how do we manage that? And the best way to deal with that is to manage it through watering, which is always the case with all plants that we grow. And citrus can actually take it drier than you would actually think. To the extent that I have gone into some of our greenhouses here and after a weekend of hot weather and looked at some citrus on a drip line and gone, they're dead, and turned the water on and come back and, you know, half a day later and they were all alive.
Right.
And I swear they were dead. They were so shriveled up. So the idea is to always water plants when they're visually dry. Mm-hmm. You can see that this pot has had a change in color from a dark soil.
This is even darker.
Yeah, that's so this has a little bit of moisture in it, and I wouldn't water that right now. I would wait. And you can, I don't know if you can see the difference here in color, but there's a drastic difference in color. So when the soil gets surface dry like that, and we see a little bit of flagging in the young leaves, it's time to thoroughly saturate the media. Keeping them evenly moist, particularly as we go into this winter time when they're not actively growing, they're not necessarily pulling a lot of moisture out of the soil, that's usually when the rots get going. Mm-hmm. And the problem with root diseases is they're always present. It's not like we can sterilize it and get out of it. It's something that's always there. The idea is to manage our culture so that they never get a foothold. And the funny thing about it is that if we took this and we planted it in the greenhouse, we'd never have to worry about it. Because for whatever reason, there's always enough new roots going out compensating whatever the disease pressure is. When you're in a pot, there's no place for them to go. And so they get caught in there, and then the disease with too much water in the soil and moisture will finally weaken the plant.
And I guess like it's part of the benefit of actually potting it in a small pot. And like you said, you've never, this has been growing in here for decades, but if you put it in too large of a pot, then you'd have too much wetness probably around that soil that would not dry out enough.
And that goes for every plant we grow, particularly for plants that are susceptible to root disease.
And is that part of the reason why you like to plant in terracotta?
Terracotta actually dries out quicker.
Yeah.
So you get a quicker dry down than you will in plastic. Plastic has its advantage, it doesn't break, it's light, we can ship it. Mm-hmm. And we grow a lot in plastic, but we have those plants that we grow, our mother plants that we grow in clay is one of them right there.
And that it takes out some of the water so the water's not sitting in there.
Yep, so the period might be a day sooner or a day and a half sooner between it needs water. That quick dry down between wet and dry inhibits the pathogens. Mm-hmm. Yep. And so in potting, we could take this plant and we could pot it into this. Mm-hmm. Or we can pot it into this. Mm-hmm. And this is a 8-inch pot, and this is a 6-inch, and my choice would be to go here.
Yeah.
In terms of pot repotting, we're using a standard peat light mix. Mm-hmm. This is peat, perlite, vermiculite. This is made by a company up in Canada. It has a small amount of fertilizer in it, which is a fertilizer charge. This is what we use for pretty much everything we grow in the greenhouse here. We do have a few soils we use, but citrus can go right in this. This has a pH of around 6, which is perfect for them. And then, now this plant actually had a tilt to it, so we're going to straighten that out.
Yeah, I noticed it was kind of leaning towards the light, so you're just kind of pulling it up so it's more straight.
Yeah, more straight and vertical, and then we simply do the potting process like that, and they were done. And now we give it a drink, settle the soil in. This, good to put your label back in so you know what you've got.
Exactly.
It's not so bad on that, but you can. And so now we have a plant that's growing vertical and has a lot of new growth on it. We could leave this be, and it will come up, or we can trim it back a little bit at this point. So at some point, you really need to do some pruning on them to contain them because they'll just become these long stalks and very open rather than keeping them. And you also need to think about how big do I want this? Where do I want this plant to go? If this was to sit on a windowsill, you don't want it to get maybe too much bigger than this.
Right. When's the best time to prune your plant?
The best time to prune them is anytime from the beginning of their growing season, which is usually in February, all the way through till it's a little late now. I'd probably let things harden off. So there's going to be a point when all of this stops, and you want to have growth that's flushed out and grown and hardened off so that it has foliage to get through the season. One of the biggest issues that people have when they're growing these plants is they get this leaf drop when they bring them in from outside. It's actually perfectly normal. And I don't know if there's any way to solve it. I've tried bringing stuff in earlier and it helps a little bit, but there's something about going from outside with all this humidity and air movement into this closed environment and the plants just like exit the leaves.
Yeah. And I know some people bring them in like it's kind of a happy medium. They bring them into their patio if they have a patio.
That's a good idea.
Or like, you know, kind of like a closed balcony a little bit more, but for people who have to bring them kind of indoors or else they would get too cold, then you're going to probably get the leaf drop.
Yeah. And the critical thing is that you don't have root rot. If you have root disease, if you don't have root rot and you're getting leaf drop, don't worry about it. You're going to look, it's going to look a little thin for a while, but they will come back out of it. And then once you've lost your leaves, you don't have that pull of moisture out of the soil. So that's where it becomes very critical that you manage your watering properly. If you overwater it, that's when the root systems, they can't dry themselves out and that problem becomes. So on a plant like this, we could actually prune it back a bit.
And that would help it get a little bushier.
Yes,
then.
And when I make these cuts, I'm not going back down, I'm not going back down too far. I'm leaving a bud or two above where they grew out so that when that breaks, it's going to be higher up. Now, if we looked at that initial growth right here, it had two leads coming out of it. So now I could potentially get three, maybe even four leads will come out of it and it'll be fuller. If we wanted to make this a shorter plant, we would make our cut down here even farther and then hold it down. But generally, because there, you can see this is a mature plant, they really need to get to be, you got to figure, you got to get that. But you can keep them smaller. I mean, that's what bonsai is.
That is bonsai, yeah.
So, I mean, basically you could sort of bonsai this theoretically in a way that would keep it very tiny, and you might get one or two fruits a year, but, which is kind of cool. You know, you get your two lemons off your little plant. Generally, you know, we want to let them get some height to them.
Well, we talked about root rot as being one of the main factors for this plant failing in your home. But let's talk about any of the types of pests that might get on the plant.
Okay, so citrus are very susceptible. We all know scale. But scale is an interesting insect. It doesn't have a lot of mobility to it. And so that scale had to come from somewhere. So if your plant is clean when you bring it in the fall outside, or you buy it and it's clean, scale is really a minor issue. And believe it or not, it's a minor issue for us at Logee's because we're able to control it and it can't move around. And then the next one is mealybug. They're a little bit more mobile, but they really live from plant to plant. And mealybug can be a problem. And there's, you know, I can just say that if you're going, if you've got mealybug and you want to solve that problem, you need to be persistent. The one application of whatever you're spraying them with, and it has to be sprayed, is not going to probably solve the problem. And really to manage mealybug, you need to do three applications. And the other thing about mealybug, and I'll just add this in, is you've got to hit them with a lot of force because there's a little cotton mass and that cotton mass has to be blown apart in order for that the eggs and the crawlers to get dislodged.
Yeah, I was going
to
say the crawlers are sometimes really tiny.
They're
you can't really see them,
tiny.
You know?
Yeah,
sometimes if I'm dealing with mealybugs and I see like a little teeny little white thing falling down, and I was like, you little mofo, if you like get on another one of my plants.
And they have ability to move some, but there's plants they prefer and plants they don't. Citrus are one that there's sort of the in-between. They'll go to something else first. And then lastly is the mites. And mites are really a problem because they can move through the air. They're spider mite, two-spotted spider mite, which is on a lot of plants. And if you put your citrus outside for the summer, when you bring it in, you're probably going to have mites on it. And so my recommendation is to get some pure neem oil, which is the leaf polisher, and mix it up with 2 tablespoons of neem and 2 teaspoons of dishwashing soap to the gallon, and spray your plants before you bring them in.
Okay.
Yeah, spray them upside down, under the leaves, wherever you are.
And a lot of people do put their citrus out for the summer and then kind of bring
right.
them
this
in.
Right, this is very, and they love it outside.
Yeah.
And then if you can remember, a week later, do it again and then move them in. And you're gonna eliminate a lot of problems that'll suddenly appear as you get into January and February. And then there's also carmine mite, which has become a major problem in greenhouse horticulture.
Is that one of the red mites?
It's actually in the same genus as spider mite, but the bios don't eat it as well.
Okay.
So it's become a problem for us because, you know, our predatory mites are not as
interested in them.
No, they're not as hip on eating them up, and you know, then we've gone to slower mites. Persimilis has been the mainstay, and then there's other mites that get on them. There's a rust mite that's a major problem in.
Is rust mite because of it causes little rust marks?
No, it actually rusts the fruit.
Oh,
so the fruit on it would become silver.
Uh-huh.
And it's a major pest in citrus growing areas. Mm. And it can get on these. It feeds on the foliage, but it doesn't seem to damage the foliage, but it will cause the outside skin to become silver. It doesn't hurt the fruit.
Yeah.
And then there's a citrus mite that feeds on the leaf that causes mottling to the leaf structure. And that is a pest of citrus that can get on. So basically, my suggestion is get yourself some neem oil and spray them. The other solution to a mite problem, which my grandfather used, was to spray them with cold water.
Interesting.
Just blast them off.
Really cold water with a hose.
With a hose, just blast, and do it every day.
It's usually my first line of defense is actually hard sprays of water even before I end up going to any kind of horticultural neem spray or anything like that.
Yeah.
I have a question in regards to fertilizing because, you know, these are putting out these big fruits, these luscious lemon-scented or very sweet-smelling flowers, and it probably grows a lot during the spring and summer months. So my question is, how do you fertilize this? I know you have a little bit of fertilizer in the potting medium that you're using, but how does somebody in the home fertilize their plant?
Well, there's a couple ways. There's many ways to do it, but one is to use a liquid fertilizer, which you DynaGrow is one that we use and sell. But there's lots out there. Miracle-Gro, I suppose, would work. And you put that into your water, and the best way to do it is to do it at a dilute solution over a period of time. Here at Logee's, we constant feed. That's not exactly the way we do it, but we feed most of the time. Very low amounts of fertilizer that go in the irrigation water. We do stop from time to time because your levels can build up too much. The other option is to get a granulated fertilizer, which is organic, and you top dress with it, and that has a residual to it. So you simply sprinkle on top of the soil, water it in, kind of scuff it in with your fingers because most of them have animal products in them. That's where the nitrogen's coming from. And so, you know, so the smell doesn't get going in the house. So you scuff it in, water it in if you're putting them outside, and you can do that periodically. I mean, basically, fertilizer, well, the nitrogen in the fertilizer makes the leaves green, and if your fertilizer is balanced and your leaves are green, you're giving it everything it needs. And the other one is slow-release fertilizers, which would be like Osmocote and such things as that, and those work fine. You can top dress on those, and that slowly releases it into the soil. I always use the word balance, because if you put too much nitrogen on them, you get more leaf growth than you do flowering, and obviously you're going for fruit, so you want to make sure it's balanced. There's some
Balance would be like a 10-10-10 or 1-1-1, so the NPK values are all balanced.
Yeah, or close. You could have like a 5-7-3 or something like that. As long as they're all there.
Yeah.
You don't want like an orchid feed is like a 30-15-15, that's like out of it, or like fish emulsion, which is some of them are balanced, but some are not. Some are very high nitrogen levels. So you want to make sure that you balance your feed. And then, you know, feed till your leaves are green and the plant's growing. Don't overdo it because you don't want to burn them up. And then you back off. At this time of year, you want to really slow that down.
So like kind of late summer, early fall. You're gonna...
And even, you know, it's easy to green a pale leaf up. But if you burn a plant, it's hot. You can't really go back on that. The leaf damage is going to be there. So it's pretty easy, and they're really not fussy.
So if we want to recap, so you want to water it thoroughly, but you want to let it dry out between waterings, and there's different ways that you could be able to help it dry out, maybe planting it in a terracotta, bringing up the airflow, and just always testing you know, beforehand so that you don't overwater it, because since it's prone to root rot.
Yeah.
You know, the things that could hit it could be scale, mealybug, and mites. It sounds like mites could happen when you bring them from outdoors in.
Yeah, and so, or you have plants in the house that have them.
That have them, and they pass through the air on from one leaf to another. Yeah. So you're going to want to bring in some neem and be a little bit more proactive with that.
Yeah.
And then pruning it back and shaping it, which is really important for those of us who have edited space and limited space. So if you're growing it on your windowsill, then you're going to want to keep it a little bit more of a smaller prune. But that might also mean that you're going to get a little less fruits to it too, as well.
And there's also that cycle of flowering, which when you make the cut, you prune the flowers off.
Mm-hmm.
So example would be on this plant right here. See, this is coming into bud.
Yep.
And it made that growth, and then the flowers come out. It had a cut right here.
Yep.
It grew, didn't flower, right? Mm-hmm. It recovered from the cut, and then its next growth, the flowers come out. And that in itself is usually pretty much the way it works, because I made that cut and the bud was way down on the stem. But it's usually that growth comes out, hardens, and then the flowers come out. So on this plant here, where we see no flowers at all, all of these tips here next spring in February will be full of flowers if you don't cut it. If we don't use them for cuttings.
Well, this is great. Well, thank you so much. I think this was really helpful in understanding kind of care and looking at how even just like the propagation of this and just taking those cuttings and seeing some of the flowers in bloom too.
Are you growing any citrus indoors? I'd love to hear about your challenges and triumphs in the comments section below. And don't forget, there are lots of great ways to gain more plant insights through Homestead Brooklyn while supporting the channel. You could check out my book, How to Make a Plant Love You, Cultivate Green Space in Your Home and Heart. Or check out the Houseplant Care Spreadsheets and the Houseplant Masterclass. Or you can even become a sustaining member of the channel for the price of a cup of coffee a month. Information is up on homesteadbrooklyn.com and in the description below.